Good morning. Welcome. Thank you for joining us. We ran into a few issues today, and it feels that we continue to, especially as Paul has been hitting the subject of anti-Semitism, and indeed, what a needed subject it is in our day. We talk much about racism in the United States, but this is, I think, an issue far beyond not only that in its magnitude, but also in its length of time, as Paul talked about last week, 2,400 years the Israelites, the Jewish people, have been facing this issue. And so we're grateful that you're with us again today as he continues to expound on that. And we pray that you'll be encouraged and challenged, not just in your walk of faith, but on these things in particular, that you might further appreciate Israel. And the Jewish people, and really the history and the heritage of Christianity, coming, you know, not adopting all their practices and everything, but really that's, we have, Christianity is strongly Jewish in its roots. So let's pray, and then we'll get into some music this morning together. Father, we are so grateful for your word, which guides us on all matters of life, particularly in this one, and showing us those opening words, in the beginning, God. And that as you orchestrate the events of this world, that everything is meant to point to you, by its end result anyway. You are meant to get the glory. And part of that great plan was choosing out a people for yourself. From the nation of Israel, started by Abraham, and our heritage as a church really is from those Jewish roots. We thank you. As various authors remark in the scriptures, we thank you for including us, putting us into the fold. And that we are able to be a part of the blessing that it is to have a relationship with you, to have salvation through Jesus Christ, to experience your grace and mercy and love. And Father, we pray that others would respond as well to the great truth of the gospel, that believers, that churches would be a strong light as Israel was meant to be. Pointing toward you, toward hope and truth that we find in you. And in a day as I've been studying this past week on a different subject entirely, that's growing increasingly dark in its understanding and more foolish, Father, we pray that your Spirit would break the chains there and really that people would see the truth for what it is. Would come to grips with reality and turn to you in faith, in obedience and service. Father, we pray that you'd guide Paul this morning. We pray for the Jewish people around the world that experience these atrocities, that the world would see the uniqueness that she is, that the Jewish people would respond to the message that Messiah has already come and is coming again, and that they would turn to you in faith. May we be bold witnesses to that fact, to these dear friends. Guide us in our conversations when they take place. Guide us this morning that we might take these things to heart and act upon them. And we ask and pray this all in your name. Amen.
Christian soldiers rise and press the battle ere the night shall veil the glowing skies. Against the foe in veils below, let all our strength be heard. Faith is the victory we know that overcomes the world. Faith is the victory. Faith is the victory. Oh, us is love, our sword, the word of God. We tread the road, the saints above, with shouts of triumph drawn. By faith they like a whirlwind's breath, swept on o'er every field. The faith by which they conquer death is still our shining shield. Faith is the victory, faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world. On every hand the foe we find, drawn up in dread array. Let tents of ease be left behind, and onward to the fray. Salvation's helmet on each head, with truth all girt about. The earth shall tremble 'neath our tread, and echo with our shout. Faith is the victory, faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world. To him that overcomes the foe, white raiment shall be given. Before the angels he shall know his name confessed in heaven. Then onward from the hills of light, our hearts with love aflame, we'll vanquish all the hosts of night in Jesus' conquering name. Faith is the victory, faith is the victory. Oh, glorious victory that overcomes the world.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. All days, oh so highly exalted.
Hi, brothers and sisters. So normally I bring information or stories about our brothers and sisters around the world that are having difficulties practicing their faith, the persecuted church. This week I wanted to bring something a little different. It's about our brothers and sisters that are helping our brothers and sisters that are having difficulties. So I looked for different groups of believers that are maybe doing some things that are pretty unique to help others live a Christian life, get the gospel out, to love on others. Some of them were pretty unique. So I have four of them. There's more, but I had four. And these are ministries and charities. And you can look them up if you're interested in supporting them. I did make sure, I did research and went through the charity websites that, you know, monitor that and make sure they're all above board. And these were all four-star organizations, some of them with some of the highest ratings I've ever seen. And, you know, just being responsible with their money, being transparent, everything. So these are four what I consider really good groups that are out there. And they're doing some unique things, so I thought I'd share four of them. So the first one, Audio Scripture Ministries. And there's other groups like this, and they actually partner with some of those. But what they do is mostly in the undeveloped part of the world, where maybe they don't have written scripture, they get the gospel to them in what they call their heart language. And Pastor Paul's actually talked about a little bit about that here on Sundays. And they, what I thought was really cool is they have these players that are solar powered. So they don't even need an infrastructure to power these. They don't have to have access to batteries or a wall outlet. These are solar powered and they're very intuitive to use. And depending on what they have in that language, they can put the New Testament, they can put the whole Bible. The Jesus film, the audio of that, God's story, that's a dramatic representation of the gospel. Even a mini Bible college to help train leaders in the faith. And then materials from Global Recordings, where they have access to over 6,000 languages. And it's pretty cool, and they're out there doing this and just trying to get the words of hope to as many people, and it doesn't have to always be written, trying to get these words of hope to as many people as they can. The next one that I thought was pretty neat on what our brothers and sisters are doing is called Cure International, C-U-R-E. So Dr. Harrison, who started this in 1986, he's an orthopedic surgeon. So he felt called to go to Malawi, a very poor country in Africa, to help do some surgeries there as a ministry, as an outreach. And he did that for a while. Then in 1996, he started this organization, CURE, which brought together more medical people. And they've actually started 8 children's hospitals throughout Africa and the Philippines. And what they do is, so in America, sometimes we don't realize how blessed we are, and we can almost feel like some of our daily woes, you know, our trials, and they are to us. But over there, simple things like a cleft palate. Maybe the child has something wrong with their feet. These orthopedic things that can be easily fixed here, you know, in the developed world, but in some of these underdeveloped countries, these brothers and sisters and their children don't have access to that. And so they started these hospitals to show God's love through helping them with these disabilities that unfortunately make them marginalized. They can't work sometimes. They can't earn, they can't farm, so they end up on the outside of society. And they thought, we can show God's love to them through these hospitals and doing the surgeries. And it's pretty neat. 5.2 million patient visits, so since 96. Over 300,000 surgeries performed since 1996 at these 8 hospitals. And the most amazing thing, almost 250,000 of these kids have made a decision for Christ in that time. That's pretty neat. And it's just these group of medical professionals that, how can we use the skill, the knowledge that God's given us to benefit His kingdom? And I thought that was really cool. So Cure International is that one. The next one is called Edify. And they're throughout Latin America and Africa, Edify is. And what they do is they think education is very important for being able to read the scriptures, to become Christ-centered leaders. And so they really focus on training and supporting and even financing some of these independent schools. And I'm going to read the part of their mission statement: to improve and expand sustainable Christ-centered education globally. They want to empower these independent schools that are popping up. There's a lot of places where school is not a given, that you're going to even have a school to send your child to if you wanted to. So when there is this opportunity, you know, somebody wants to start a school, they partner with them. And they, you know, curriculums, training, resources, technological resources, and they place a strong focus on the training the leaders and the teachers to provide a biblically based, high-quality education and to develop a Christ-like character in the students. They see that believers need to be leaders, and their statements are that to be a leader, you have to be educated. You have to be able to think well. And we see in America especially how our schools are being used, you know, by the enemy sometimes to turn our children away from a Christ-centered life. They're fighting back against that. And they see schools as an opportunity to live a Christ-centered life and to lead in a Christ-centered manner. And I thought that was really cool. And the last one kind of tickled my funny bone. So some of you may not know, I'm an engineer. I'm an electrical engineer. So this ministry just stood out to me. It's called Engineering Ministries International. So they're throughout Latin America, Africa, and Asia. They have over 200 different kinds of engineers and interns. And what they do is they do engineering for people that are doing projects, God-centered projects, Christ-centered projects around the world. The infrastructure, or maybe it's an agriculture and you need a water engineer, or, you know, you're building a school, or, you know, even laying out the roads around your town. You know, you need something like that. And these are Christian brothers and sisters that are engineers that have this skill, and they wanted to put it to work for the kingdom. So they do engineering for brothers and sisters around the world. And I thought that's really cool. All of these are really cool, actually. But it's really finding, you know, we read the parable of the talons, and it's we're given work to do. You have the skill to do it. God equips us in finding the way that you can most benefit the kingdom. And these brothers and sisters in these four different ministries, I think, are doing a great job. So I'll read them again. So that was Audio Scripture Ministries, Cure International, Engineering Ministries International, and Edify. And I think these brothers and sisters are, you know, out there about it. And I'm really glad that of the unique ways they're serving the kingdom. So let's go to the Lord in prayer and lift them up. Father God, it always comes back to you. You equip your body, your church, to minister to itself, to spread the gospel to the unreached. You give us knowledge, you give us skills, all of these things, and I am blessed to see these brothers and sisters taking what you've given them and putting it to work for your kingdom. I thank you for them, and I ask you to bless them, to, you know, whether it's, you know, they're in difficult parts of the world, that whether it's legal issues, paperwork, or, you know, maybe surrounding people that don't like them being there, whatever it is, that you're protecting them, and you're letting their light shine as bright as it can in these areas, that they are a blessing to the people that they're helping, and that they can reach as many people as possible, that your Holy Spirit guides them, gives them the wisdom to do the work of your kingdom with these unique skill sets and these unique passions they brought to the table. We thank you for them, and we thank you for the people they're helping. In Jesus' name, thank you. Thank you, brothers and sisters.
Hail to the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings, the Lord Jesus Christ.
All hail. Ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount, I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, here by thy great help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure, safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God, he to rescue me from danger, interposed his precious blood. Precious blood. Oh, that day when freed from sinning, I shall see thy lovely face. Clothed then in blood-washed linen, how I'll sing thy sovereign grace. Come, my Lord, no longer tarry, take my ransomed soul away. Send thine angels now to carry me to realms of endless day. Oh, to grace how great a debtor, daily I am constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
Good morning. Do you enjoy doing jigsaw puzzles? Many people in the world do enjoy puzzles. We might say that some people are even addicted to them. They can't walk away from it without putting a piece or two in the place, and maybe they get stuck and do a whole lot more. I did a quick check. There are some that are almost impossible puzzles, like the double-sided one with the same image on both sides and one turned 90 degrees to the other, or the black spiral or the clear plastic one. For most of us, we stick to the ones with a nice picture on the box lid, and it always helps to see the big picture, doesn't it? Helps us to fit the pieces into the place. You know, life is like somewhat like a jigsaw puzzle, but we don't have the picture of our lives on a box lid, and we certainly don't have all the pieces either. And life can seem chaotic because we don't know how our life pieces fit together for ourselves and then in our relationships with everyone else and everything around us. That chaos causes a lot of anxiety, doesn't it? We are like puzzles within a puzzle. Fortunately, God knows the big picture for each of us as individuals, as well as the big picture for nations and the big picture for all of his creation, his creatures, and the entire universe. He has graciously given us enough information in his word to see some of the picture. His word is the only book in the world that crosses cultures and history, and it makes it relevant for every generation. So that means it's relevant for today, July 24th, 2022. Sadly, many people who claim to know God have never read all of his word. They've never realized that God is sovereignly moving what appears to be total chaos in the world to a picture that displays his character qualities and abilities in a way that we'll see some of it at the conclusion of the 1,000 years of human history in his earthly kingdom coming. So here's God's basic story, and this is the very short version, and I know the details, but I'm condensing it. God created everything seen and unseen, and it was perfect. At some point in the past history, his highest angelic being rebelled and convinced other angels to follow him, creating a rebel kingdom. We call this angelic being that led the rebellion Satan. He also deceived the man and the woman that God created in his image. And I know the details, and again, I'm just summarizing. They disobeyed God's command to them not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. By their disobedience, they joined the rebel kingdom of Satan. The Bible, God's Word, not only tells us part of the story, but answers the questions, how does God deal with the rebel kingdom of men and women? And how can he get men and women back under his reign and into a close relationship with him that he intended when he created Adam and Eve? The answer is yes, God can get the kingdom back by redeeming mankind from their sinful rebellion. He himself came as a redeemer when the time was right. He came into the world as the God-man united in one person, Jesus. He came through the family of a man named Abraham, who he chose before 2,100 years earlier. Abraham's family eventually became the people of the nation of Israel, the Jewish people. And God's intention was to have people personally believe that he is their redeemer. He frees them from the penalty of sin and death when they accept his gift package of forgiveness and reconciliation to him. People who trust him to do that move from the rebel kingdom to being part of God's own family. Now, most of the people in Israel in Jesus' time did not take his offer. Instead, they crucified him. Through Jesus' death, he fulfilled part of the big picture plan. Someone had to die for the sins of the humans, because the sin penalty was death. If Jesus took the sins on himself as a substitute, then people would not have to die and be forever in the rebel kingdom and eventually experience eternal death. God has always given people an opportunity to respond to him in belief that he has graciously paid the price for their sin and they can be part of his family, forgiven, reconciled, made righteous. And God's plan was that his redeemed followers would multiply and tell the message to others that redemption is available. A perfect kingdom began, but a rebel kingdom grew up hating and opposing God and everything that God wanted to do. Will God ever get his perfect kingdom back, where there's peace, relational harmony, justice, and creation becomes as it was when God created it? And again, the answer is yes. Within the scope of human history, Jesus himself will come back to the earth to be king for 1,000 years. The earth will be changed, the curse on the earth will be removed, and the earth will return to the Eden-like condition it was in before sin came into Adam and Eve's lives. During Jesus' reign, though, Satan will be chained so he cannot deceive people. And after that 1,000 years, he'll be let go, and he will lead a final rebellion against Jesus. Satan will be defeated in a moment and sentenced to an eternity in the lake of fire, along with all who were part of his rebel kingdom during all of human history. And that's the picture on the puzzle box that God's working to complete. It will be completed, and you can read the whole story in your Bibles. It sounds simple when reduced to a few paragraphs, but it is much more complex. As king of the rebel kingdom, Satan continues to attempt to thwart God's plans and hurt God's people. He wants his own rebel kingdom to expand by deceiving people at every level of their existence. He is behind the world hating God and hurting God's people. We talked about anti-Semitism last week and gave a brief history of it going back 2,400 years up to the present, and now we are in the present. And nations and even churches stand against Israel. July 13th, just a week and a half ago, the foreign ministries or ministers of Belgium, Denmark, France, Germany, Ireland, Italy, the Netherlands, Spain, and Sweden agreed to continue what they called their cooperation and strong support for the civil society in the occupied Palestinian territories. And they saw that a free and strong civil society is indispensable for promoting democratic values. This was according to Dr. Shimon Samuels, who is the Director of International Relations for the Simon Wiesenthal Center. These European countries obviously don't even recognize that those territories belong to Israel in reality. The Gaza Strip is run by the terrorist group Hamas, and that's financed by Qatar and Iran. Both Hamas and the Palestinian Authority charters call for the murder of Jews anywhere and the destruction of Israel. These 9 European countries must be missing the obvious. Democratic values and civil society have no place in Gaza or the West Bank, as it's called. United Nations Relief and Works Agency for the Palestinian Refugees, that's a big title, they have been perpetuating the Palestinian refugee status for the last 70 years rather than solving it. You'd think in 70 years they'd be able to do something about it, but no. That same organization or agency is currently financing school books to teach Palestinian children to hate and murder Jews. These nine countries with educated leadership may as well rub Aladdin's lamp and make a wish for something that cannot happen as long as Hamas and other terrorist groups are in control of the Palestinian people under them. Those nine European nations are supporting terrorist leadership. And what's called the occupied Palestinian territories, people are living, and they are most often victims of their own leaders suppressing truth, multiplying lies, lining their own pockets, and being tyrants in control over the people as if they were pieces of property. It's very sad for the Palestinian people as their leaders promote hate and violence and terrorism toward Israel and others. You know, I'm convinced that the Palestinian people, not the leaders, but the people in general, probably don't agree with those types of things. I know they've been brainwashed, and many of them probably do perpetuate that, but I think that they don't like to have that kind of stuff going on. The problem of anti-Semitism is not only in what we'd call modern nations, it's also in churches in the USA and the world. For example, July 8th, just a few weeks ago, the General Assembly of the Presbyterian Church USA passed a deceitful resolution that falsely defines Israel as a apartheid state. And according to Rabbi Eric Greenberg, it is an insult to Jews and Christians alike and damages interfaith relations. At a vote of 266 to 116, that was a pretty overwhelming vote. There was also testimony that the PCUSA leaders rigged the debate on the resolution by providing untrue and misleading information to church members and preventing any Jewish or pro-Israel voices to oppose the proposed resolution. And among the falsehoods promoted by the PCUSA leadership was comparing Israel policy to Nazi Germany and falsely claiming that there was widespread Jewish support for the resolution. PCUSA is a specific denomination, so we're not painting with a broad brush. This is not all Presbyterians. But we are talking about how anti-Semitism has crept into the church. There's another current problem of anti-Semitism in the church, and it is much wider than that, and it's called, in short, BDS. And it means boycott, divestment, and sanctions. It is a Palestinian-led movement that has gathered large numbers of U.S. organizations, businesses, industries, and educational institutions, including church denominations, to stand against Israel by boycotting all Israeli goods, pulling out investments from Israeli businesses and education and cultural institutions, and also imposing sanctions on them in an effort to destroy the nation through hurting the Israeli economy, education, and culture. Now, there are at least nine major U.S. church denominations involved. They are materially participating to some degree in this boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement. And these are the Alliance of Baptists, and I was curious as to who the Alliance was made up of, and that would curl your hair. It's not the general group of Baptists that we would normally understand Baptist being. It's a squirrely group. Church of United Brethren in Christ, the Religious Society of Friends, that would be the Quakers, the Mennonite Church USA, Presbyterian Church USA, Roman Catholic Church, Unitarian Universalist Association, United Church of Christ, United Methodist Church. These are examples of some of the main ones. Anti-Semitism is definitely designed to hurt Israel as a nation and people group. So what's the point? The point is that national and world government leaders, as well as church leaders in major denominations in our country and in the world, are involved in anti-Semitic issues, and it is trickling down to others as well. Now, many of you, or maybe some of you, and not many, but maybe some of you have read Joel Rosenberg's books, and he has written many. Joel Rosenberg spoke at the 9/11 and New Middle East Conference in New York about a year ago. Mr. Rosenberg was being interviewed by Mitch Glasser, president of the Chosen People Ministries, and the Chosen People Ministries was a co-organizer of the conference. We happen to support, as a church, Chosen People Ministry missionaries in Israel. Rosenberg said, and this is a quote, "Evangelical Christians should not take an either-or stance on the support for Israel or the Palestinians," unquote. Now, Joel Rosenberg is an Israeli citizen. He's also a founding member of the Alliance for Peace of Jerusalem. And Rosenberg said, "God is not an either-or God. He doesn't love one side to the exclusion of the other. He is a both and God." Again, I quote, "Too much of evangelism is split into camps. They are either pro-Israel and therefore they feel that they don't even need to talk about the Palestinians, or their language and tone is hostile toward the Palestinians. And the other side, in the other camp," he said, "some evangelicals can be hostile to Israel. They consider Israel an apartheid state," unquote. Now, Rosenberg is an Israeli citizen, and he also continued, "Arabs serve on our Supreme Court in Israel. They serve as regular judges, police officers, heads of banks. They can form political parties. They can vote as citizens. They have members of the Knesset who are, we have members of the Knesset who are Arabs. That is not apartheid," he said, unquote. Now, if it was apartheid, none of that would be true. It would not happen. That brings us to GPS number one, God's position stance. And that is that the Israelis, the Jews, and Palestinians need Jesus. Mr. Rosenberg called on the church to take the lead in loving Israel and their neighbors, and not thinking that an advantage for one side must be a loss for the other side. Gentiles need Jesus as well. Do not everybody need Jesus? We appreciate our missionary, Justin Kron, who co-produced the feature-length movie, Hope in the Holy Land. It is an excellent balance of the needs of Israelis and Palestinians. And born-again believers are in both groups, in the Jewish believers and Israelis, as well as the Palestinians. Check out hopeintheholyland.com for more information. It's an excellent movie, and I personally benefited by it quite a bit. David Brickner, the director of Jews for Jesus, wrote an excellent article called What Christians Should Know About Jewish People. And he dittoed or agreed or echoed Rosenberg's comments that Jewish people need Jesus. Remember, during the Gospels, Jesus was talking to Jewish people during his ministry. He told Nicodemus, a Jewish religious leader, "You must be born again." And Jesus popped the Pharisees' bubble of belief. They thought because they were descendants of Abraham, they were right with God. But Jesus told them, "You are from below. I am from above. You belong to this world. I do not. That's why I said to you, you will die in your sins. For unless you believe that I am who I claim to be, you will die in your sins." You can find that in John chapter 8. So amongst the Jewish people, if they don't believe that Jesus is who he claimed to be, their Messiah, they will die in their sins. Brickner's next point was that Christians need to know that many Jews do not have a biblical belief in God. He said many Jews are agnostic. They don't know if there's a God, or atheists believing there is no God. And some believe God exists, but that he is uninvolved in their lives. Brickner was a student at Moody Bible Institute in Chicago, where I went to school years ago. The students went out in teams during the week to different neighborhoods to engage people in spiritual conversations, and I remember doing that also. He happened to be in an Orthodox Jewish area, and he met a rabbi's wife when she came to the door. And after some conversation, he asked, as he said, a standard evangelistic question, "Do you know where you'll go when you die?" And the woman answered, "Down the street to the cemetery." That was it. David Brickner said she had no thought about or hope of a life after this one. Brickner's third comment was this: Christians need to know that Jewish people are still a people of divine destiny. This is exciting because there are many Old Testament prophecies that are unfulfilled. They are still on God's to-do list. Now, God doesn't wake up in the morning and check the list like we do, but he still has a to-do list, and we have a good part of it in our Old Testament in the prophecies. Pastor Daniel mentioned last week how we interpret our Bibles here at Grace Bible Church. We believe in the literal, grammatical, historical method of interpretation. The big word is hermeneutics. It's the science and art of interpretation. And there are rules that we follow when we do our studying. We look at the context, the paragraphs, the section, the book. We look at the words. What did they mean to the original hearers in that part of the world in the language that they spoke? What is the grammar of the sentence? What was the culture that we are bridging from the Mideastern culture years ago to our U.S. culture today? What was going on in history around the biblical events? And when we say we take the Bible literally, it means that we let the words mean what words normally mean unless the context demands otherwise. You know, we read most books, magazines, text, emails that way. We don't superimpose other meanings on what we read. The Bible is not written in secret code. It drives me nuts to see books entitled The Code of the Bible. That is crazy. The Bible was meant to be understood. Many of you may have read Pilgrim's Progress. That story is an allegory. It is intended to carry a deeper meaning, and that's what allegories are. It's a story, but it's intended to teach something else. And in Pilgrim's Progress's case, it is something that something is teaching about the Christian life. Now, we use figures of speech and idioms and parables and symbols, and those are all legitimate forms of communicating and writing. But we understand them to communicate a concept. It's fun to go into another country and hear their idioms as opposed to some of our idioms. When we say it's raining cats and dogs, what do you understand that I mean by that? It's not raining literal cats and dogs and we are getting bopped by furry animals. It means it's raining hard. And what about I have butterflies in my stomach? It means I'm anxious about something or a little nervous. It doesn't mean that I'm on a new diet. Now, why bring this up? Because there's another method of Bible interpretation that has brought a lot of confusion as well as anti-Semitic attitudes into the more biblical churches, even around us here in Sheboygan County in Wisconsin. And that method is called allegorical interpretation. Another word might be spiritualizing things, which sees the words in some passages of Scripture, and especially prophetic passages, meaning something other than what it says. Now, hang on to that thought a minute, because I want to go back a little bit in history and show you how we got there. Remember last week, the Roman Emperor Hadrian crushed a Jewish revolt in 135 AD, and he exiled the Jews from Israel. That exile of the Jews out of Israel made some of the Gentile Christians think it was the judgment of God on the Jews and that the church replaced Israel as God's people. And they connected the wrong dots. They made a wrong conclusion. The early church in Acts was made up of Jewish people who had come to trust Jesus as Messiah. And as persecution of the Jewish Christians began to spread, Christianity began to spread north into Antioch, into Syria. And more Gentiles got saved and became part of the church. Paul, Barnabas, and others evangelized both Jews and Gentiles. But proportionally, the Gentiles began to outnumber the Jews as believers. Last week, I mentioned that some of the early church fathers felt that the Jews had forfeited God's blessings and that the church took over enjoying them. Now, there are four streams that were coming together that gets us where we are right now. One is that circumstance of the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple in 70 AD. The second was the exile of the Jews from Israel in 135. And then the Gentiles becoming the majority group in the churches around the Roman Empire. And the fourth one is that allegorical method of interpreting the Scripture. Those four things came together and gave rise to the church, idea that the church had replaced Israel and God's program in the world. One of the church fathers named Origen, who was a leader in the church in the third century, he used and taught others this allegorical method of interpretation of the Bible. And the big problem with the allegorical method of interpretation is you can make the Bible say whatever you want. It is very subjective, opens the door to a lot of false teaching, and there is no objective check on what the words mean. I'll give you a couple quick examples. One of the allegories that people claim is the Song of Solomon or Song of Songs. And it says that the Christian allegorical interpreters have suggested that the book depicts the love between Christ and his bride, the church. Now, there was no church in the Old Testament. Solomon didn't see ahead Christ and the church. And that is a misinterpretation of the Song of Solomon to claim that it is a picture of Christ and the church. Another one that I wasn't as familiar with is Jonah, although I'd heard it as being unbelievable or a myth, but some people take it as an allegory that Jonah represents Israel, the large fish represents Babylon as a world power that swallowed up Israel, that Nineveh had to do with the conversion of the Gentiles, and Jonah's complaint was the objection by the Jews to the inclusion of the Gentiles amongst them. And again, you can see how subjective it is. I mean, you could make that stuff mean anything you want, and there'd be no objective check on it. Now, let's take an example from the Bible that is prophetic, and that is out of Zechariah chapter 14, verses 1 through 5. And I'll read it for you. He says, "Watch, for the day of the Lord is coming when your possessions will be plundered right in front of you. I will gather all nations to fight against Jerusalem. The city will be taken, the houses looted, the women raped. Half of the population will be taken into captivity, and the rest will be left among the ruins of the city. Then the Lord will go out and fight against those nations as he's fought in times past. On that day, his feet will stand on the Mount of Olives east of Jerusalem. And the Mountain of Olives will split apart, making a wide valley running from east to west. Half the mountain will move toward the north and half toward the south. You will flee through this valley, for it will reach across to Azal. Yes, you will flee as you did from the earthquake in the days of King Uzziah in Judah. Then the Lord, my God, will come and all his holy ones with him." Now, what do we understand that these five verses say plainly? There's going to be a very bad attack against Jerusalem. Jesus will personally and physically will come to the Mount of Olives, and the Mount of Olives splits in two with an east-west valley between them. So that would be the normal interpretation. Let it speak plainly. The allegorical interpretation, according to John McKay, explains verse 2 this way. And here's the quote. "The message is that the future of the church will involve a time when it will be surrounded by its enemies and seemingly overwhelmed by them. And under the metaphor of pillaging an ancient city, the church is presented as suffering grievously at the hands of her enemies, and yet there shall be a remnant," unquote. Zechariah is not talking about the church. The church is not on any Old Testament radar screen. The New Testament calls it a mystery. It was unrevealed in the Old Testament. We cannot read the church back into the Old Testament, as many people try to do. Now, there are illustrations, but that is different than saying it means this, and that was the intention of the authors back then to make it mean that by this symbolic language. So the allegorical method of interpreting the Bible, and specifically the Old Testament, allows for the promises and prophecies given to Israel to be picked up by the church, since in their understanding, the church has replaced Israel. See why that would be so much of a problem? We come to GPS number 2. God's plan for Israel is still moving forward with prophecies yet to be fulfilled. I go back to chapter 11 of Isaiah, and much of this chapter, in fact, most of the chapter has not been fulfilled. I'll read it. "Out of the stump of David's family will grow a shoot, yes, a new branch bearing fruit from the old root." Well, we know that is partly fulfilled in Jesus coming his first time as Messiah, and we know it's from David's family. Then we move on to verse 4. "He will give justice to the poor and make fair decisions for the exploited." And I don't know that Jesus did a lot of that in his ministry. I mean, he healed, he certainly encouraged the poor, but it was a spiritual message. It wasn't dealing with the social issues of Israel. And then we really get to something that's not been fulfilled. In that day that Isaiah is talking about in the future, it says the wolf and lamb will lie down together. The leopard will lie down with the baby goat. The calf and the yearling will be safe with the lion, and a little child will lead them all. Nothing will hurt or destroy in all my holy mountain, For as the waters fill the sea, so the earth will be filled with people who know Yahweh, the true and living God, the Creator and the Redeemer. And verse 10 says, in that day the heir to David's throne will be a banner of salvation to all the world. In that day the Lord will reach out his hand and a second time bring back the remnant of his people. He will raise a flag among the nations and assemble the exiles of Israel. He will gather the scattered people of Judah from the ends of the earth. That has not been fulfilled. We don't see animals living like that today. We don't see peace. We don't see the heir of David's throne ruling and being the banner of salvation. We move to Amos chapter 9. It says, the Lord has spoken. He will do these things. A time will come, says the Lord, when the grain and grapes will grow faster than they can be harvested. Well, we don't see that happening. I mean, Israel's done a great job in redeeming the desert and doing a great job with their agriculture, but it's not like this. It says, the terraced vineyards on the hills of Israel will drip with sweet wine. I will bring my exiled people of Israel back from distant lands. They will rebuild their ruined cities and live in them again. They will plant vineyards and gardens and eat their crops and drink their wine. And, you know, if we stop there, we could say, well, that is regarding the return from Persia after the Babylonian captivity. But wait, he says in verse 15, I will firmly plant them there in their own land, and they will never again be uprooted from the land I have given them. Well, Israel has been in and out of the land a lot of times. And while they're back as a nation, they are not spiritually back to enjoy these particular things. We go to Jeremiah chapter 31. But this is the new covenant I will make with the people of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my instructions deep within them. I will write them on their hearts. I will be their God. They will be my people. They will not need to teach their neighbors, nor will they need to teach their relatives, saying, you should know the Lord. For everyone from the least to the greatest will know me already. I will forgive their wickedness and never again remember their sins. Now you're probably saying, Paul, doesn't the church benefit by that? And yes, it does. When Jesus began the new covenant, it began with his death, and we are beneficiaries of part of that new covenant. We don't take the land blessings that God is offering here, but we do certainly have God's instructions written in our heart because the Holy Spirit has come in to live with us. And it says he writes them on our heart. And we are still doing the work of evangelism. But in the future, when the new covenant is really fulfilled in the nation of Israel, people will know Jesus is the Messiah. There'll be no need specifically for evangelism. They will need our people during the kingdom when Jesus is reigning will still need to make a decision of trusting him as the Messiah. And I'm talking about the ones that are born during those years. In Jeremiah 31, how secure is this? It says, this is what Yahweh of heaven's army says in Jeremiah 31, 36. He says, I'm as likely to reject my people as Israel, as I am to abolish the laws of nature. And I like what he says also in Jeremiah 33. This is the Lord's message that came to Jeremiah another time. You've surely noticed what these people are saying, haven't you? They're saying the Lord has rejected the two families of Israel and Judah that he chose. So they have little regard for my people will ever be a nation again. Now that sounds just like today, doesn't it? People are saying the Lord's rejected those people. Now here's what verse 25 says. But I, the Lord, make the following promise. I've made a covenant governing the coming of day and night. I've established fixed laws governing heaven and earth. He's talking about the stellar heavens, I believe. And just as surely as I have done this, so surely I will never reject the descendants of Jacob, nor will I ever refuse to choose one of my servant David's descendants to rule over the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Indeed, I will restore them and show mercy to them. Now, if you see the sun come up and go down every day, every night, if you see day and night, if the stars aren't falling out of the heavens and they're not crashing into each other, God is still going to carry this promise out. That's what he's talking about here. If you can upset the laws of nature and science that God has fixed, God says, then I'll reject them. But no one's ever done that, have they? This promise is so secure, and I appreciate that very much, and I hope you do as well. But that's what he's talking about. We come to GPS number 3. God's plan for evangelism includes the Jews and the Gentiles. It always has. If we read through the book of Acts, we will be very convinced that Paul and Barnabas's evangelism strategy was to go to the synagogues first, share the good news about Jesus being the Messiah and his death and resurrection for their salvation. Some trusted Jesus, many didn't, and Paul went on to the Gentiles if he wasn't thrown in prison or run out of town first. Romans 1:16, Paul says to the Romans, the Gentiles as well as the Jews, "For I am not ashamed of this good news about Christ. It is the power of God at work, saving everyone who believes, the Jew first and also to the Gentile." I remember hearing a Messianic Jew speaking years ago, and the idea was, it's not the Jew first, it's the Jew not at all. It seems like that has been the attention of Christians. It's the Jew not at all, not the Jew first, and also to the Gentile. We need to correct that. What was Paul's attitude toward his own people, the Jews? I mean, yes, he became a believer and he worked primarily or a lot with Gentiles, but here's what he said in Romans 10, verse 1. "Brothers and sisters, my heart's desire, my prayer to God on behalf of my fellow Israelites is for their salvation. For I can testify that they're zealous for God, but their zeal is not in line with the truth. For ignoring the righteousness that comes from God and instead seeking to establish their own righteousness, they did not submit to God's righteousness. For Christ is the end of the law, with the result that there is righteousness for everyone who believes." What's the condition for getting right with God? It is accepting his righteousness through Christ. Romans 11:1, Paul says, and again, asking that question, "So I ask, God has not rejected his people, has he?" "Absolutely not," he says. "For I too am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham from the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people whom he foreknew." You know, Paul couldn't believe that the church replaced Israel, or did not believe that the church replaced Israel in God's program. He saw them as a national entity, but as unbelievers. What was God's promise to Abraham? Remember, we talked about that last week in Genesis 12. "In you, all the families of the earth will be blessed." And Paul picked that up in Galatians chapter 3 and verse 8. He says, "The scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, proclaimed the gospel to Abraham ahead of time, saying, all the nations will be blessed in you." Well, that was a reference to Jesus, Messiah, coming to save Jews and Gentiles and putting them in one body, the church, during this particular age. So then, even those who believe are blessed along with Abraham, the believer. Last GPS, here are some things that we can do as believers now. We need to have a biblical view of Israel and the Jewish people, their place in history, and God's love for them and his plans for them. You're only going to get that by reading your Bible carefully, and I hope that you would. We can also appreciate the many good things that have come from the Jewish and Israeli people, and that list is way too long to enumerate in the last 100 years of what they've done. I'm sure it's available. You can look it up, of all the things that the Jewish people have contributed to our lives in society and in the world. Second thing, pray for Jewish people that we might know, and even for those we don't know, that they would have open hearts to the gospel. We need to witness graciously and appropriately, using Old Testament as we have opportunity to talk to the Jewish people. You can use the gospel out of the Old Testament as well. And we need to listen carefully first, where people are, what are they thinking. Another thing we can do is financially support ministries to the Jewish people, both here in the USA and Israel and elsewhere in the world. As a church, we support some Jewish ministries. And some years ago, it dawned on me that I wasn't supporting any Jewish ministries financially on a regular basis, and I got involved in doing that as well. So I'd encourage you to do that as you think about your giving program in the Lord. And I hope that that's systematic as well. Another thing, be aware of what's going on in the nation of Israel now, not through mainstream media, but through some trustworthy sources. And there are some of those out there. So be aware what's going on. Be aware of anti-Semitic gobbledygook going on too. And it's going to come at us. We hear it frequently. It is something that's on the news frequently as well. We need to sort that out. So a quick review. Many world and national government leaders and even church leaders are anti-Semitic and stand against Israel. God's plan for evangelism includes Israelis, Jews, Palestinians, Gentiles, all ethnicities. Get that right. When God says go into the world, he includes everybody. Christians need to know that Jewish people are still a people of divine destiny. God has a plan for Israel. It is still moving forward with prophecies that are yet to be fulfilled, future to us. We also need to reject the allegorical interpretation methods and replacement theology. That's another thing that's called, that comes out of that the church replaced Israel. That's a much bigger package. And the BDS, the boycott, divestment, and sanction movement. The church has not replaced Israel, and we can praise the Lord for that. Let's lock in to God's program and God's plan and God's person. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for what you're doing. We thank you for your promises being so secure that if we could change day and night, your promises would go away. But we can't. We thank you for the promises spiritually as well as physically of things that you are going to do in the nation of Israel in the future. Lord, help us to be alert to the people around us needing you, whether they be Jews or Gentiles. We thank you for Jesus, our Messiah, King of the universe, and we look forward to his coming to take us out of the world as well as to set up his kingdom. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
How I long to breathe the air of heaven, where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets, to look upon the one who bled to save me and walk with him for all eternity. There will be a day when all will bow before him. There will be a day when death will be no more. Standing face to face with he who died and rose again. Holy, holy is the Lord. And every prayer we prayed in desperation, the songs of faith we sang through doubt and fear, in the end we'll see that it was worth it when he returns to wipe away our tears. Oh, with one voice, a thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And on that day we join the resurrection and stand beside the heroes of the faith. With one voice, thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. So let it be today. We shall be.
we conclude today, I want to read a verse from Jeremiah, just reminding us that there are future plans in store yet. Starting in verse 3 from chapter 31, he will say to them, I have loved you with an everlasting love. That is why I have continued to be faithful to you. I will rebuild you, my dear children, Israel, so that you will once again be built up. Again, once again, you will take up the tambourine and join in the happy throng of dancers. Once again, you will plant vineyards on the hills of Samaria. Those who plant them will once again enjoy their fruit. Yes, a time is coming when the watchman will call out on the mountains of Ephraim, come, let us go to Zion to worship the Lord our God. And we look forward to that day, ultimately looking forward to Christ's return, and what a day that'll be. Thanks for joining us today. Until next week, God bless.